This is part two in our YouTube Helm video tutorial series. This is an extract from a full 30-hour Kubernetes training course, which you can find in the link in the description below. But if you're just here for Helm, let's continue with the second video, which covers installing Helm charts. Well, in the previous video, we talked very briefly about what Helm is. And we went through the very trivial process of installing Helm onto our cluster. Well, continuing the story, we're imagining that we've been given the job of installing MySQL, just a random example, but it will do, into our cluster. We know that we need some pods and some deployments, maybe, possibly stateful sets, I don't know, and services. It looks like a lot of work to do that. So we're going to use Helm to install a predefined package into our cluster. Now, I gave a hint that we're going to be able to run a command something like helm install MySQL, but I'm not even going to bother running that command because it won't work, and it won't work for a couple of reasons. But the main reason, and the one that we need to talk about now, is where do we find these packages? Now, you might have been imagining that we're going to get a kind of predefined single repository containing every single software package in the world. Unfortunately, that's not the case, or at least it isn't at the time of recording. I'm recording in 2021, and I'm hoping this may change over time, but as things are right now, unfortunately, it's the case that if you want a particular software package in Helm, you have to go and find a repository containing it. I'm going to go into a lot more detail on this later on, and we'll have a look at the politics behind this, but for now I'm going to keep things as simple as possible. And the big thing to learn is there is a kind of corresponding website alongside Helm called artifacthub.io. Now, it might not be obvious that this site is related to Helm because it talks a lot about we can search for packages and we can browse packages and so on, but it doesn't directly mention Helm. And that's because if I go all the way down to the bottom, this site does actually support a number of different packaging techniques. But for me, Helm is by far the biggest. So if you want, you can think of Artifact.io as being the central point for Helm packages, although they talk more generally here about Kubernetes packages. So what we can do here on the search, of course, is we can search for packages that we're interested in. So in our example, we're looking for MySQL. And let's have a look at the results we get. Well, the first thing to mention is I am getting more than one result for MySQL. And that's definitely one of the things we're going to be talking about very soon. As I say, though, for this demo, I'm keeping things as simple as possible. And I'm going to focus straight in on what for me was the first result. It might not be the first result for you, but we're looking for the result that mentions Bitnami. And as I keep saying, there will be more information on about what all this means, what is Bitnami, why do we have multiple results, coming up later. But for now, we're just going to click straight through to this link. And very helpfully here, they have a TLDR section. Basically just a quick start. We actually need two commands to install this MySQL. And that's because the first command is going to configure our Helm to recognize this particular repository provided by this organization called Bitnami. There's more than one repository out there in the world. Unfortunately, there isn't a single repository. It's more of an ecosystem. For now, let's just enter the command. The command is helm repo add. But there are two arguments into this command. The first of the arguments is actually just a label. It's a name that we're going to give to this repository. When we go a little further with Helm, we are going to be able to do things like listing repositories and generally managing them. And this name Bitnami is just a recognizable label that we want to use. So you could use any name you like in here, but we really probably don't want to change it because the repository is officially called Bitnami, so we may as well stick with that name. The second parameter is simply the URL of that repository. So let's do that then. Helm repo add. And as I say, no need to change the label, which will be Bitnami. And then the URL, which you can type in or you can get yourself from the artifacthub.io page. And if all goes well, hoping the repository still exists by the time you watch this, we should get a message saying that has now been added to our repositories. Okay, that repository will contain a number of different packages. By the way, you can also see the word chart appearing several times on this page. And you can think of a chart as just being a Helm term that means a package. And through these videos, I'm probably going to use the term chart and package interchangeably. So now we finally come to the important command, I guess, which is the Helm install. Again, there are two separate parameters into this command. The first parameter is again a label or a name that we're going to give to this installation. And that's going to allow us to manage the installation later on. For example, when we want to uninstall MySQL at a later date, then we'll be referring to it using this label. Also, this command is going to be starting up pods, adding services and several other Kubernetes objects into our cluster. And it will actually use this string as a prefix on all of those objects that it creates. So really, you really do want this to be a recognizable, understandable label. So actually, my release is a rubbish label. Use something recognizable. I would suggest for us, a label like MySQL would be perfect. The second parameter is the name of the package that we're installing. Of course, in this example, that's MySQL. But there is a bit in front of it here. It might not be obvious what that is, but that's actually the name of the repository that we're getting the installation from. And that's the label that we defined in step one here. So we could have used any label we like here in step one. We happen to follow the example and use Bitnami. But whatever label we used there, we would be copying it here in this step. So I hope that makes sense. I do sometimes find that slightly confusing, but once you understand how it hangs together, it's pretty simple. We're going to do a Helm install, followed by the name that we want to use in our cluster to manage this installation. And I'm going to suggest a simple MySQL. And then, which repository are we installing from? Well, we have a repository that we've called Bitnami. So we reflect that here, /, and then the name of the package at that repository, which happens to be called MySQL. That's matching our label, but it didn't have to. We could have used anything we like right here. Let's see if this works. Of course, if you get an error here at this point, then check everything that you've done so far. Check that those labels match. Check for any typos. But I must admit, I find the Helm output here to be really quite annoying because we've got like a page full, a terminal full of output. And it always looks to me at first glance like, whoa, this is an error. But actually, it is saying if you unpick this, it is saying that is installing MySQL. There's a note here to be patient while it's being deployed, but it is saying that we can watch the status using standard kubectl get pods command. We'll ignore all of the rest of the stuff. While we've been talking, I reckon if I do a kubectl get po, I'll still do this on all namespaces. And let's see what's different. Well, can you see that we do have a pod now running in the default namespace? We didn't have that before. The pod is called MySQL0. Well, I can tell you now that it got the name of that pod using that label that we just defined on the install command. So that's a very good reason why you need to be careful with that. If we'd used my release, we wouldn't have a clue what this pod was doing. Now, although I've been talking a while, it's still getting up and running, so I'll need to wait a bit. Well, I had to stop recording there because it took quite a long time for the pod to start up for some reason. I thought it would be quicker than that, but it took well over 3 minutes for me. But no matter, the point is, eventually, that pod is now up and running. So we know that it seems to have installed into the default namespace. We'll need to have a look at how to override that shortly. But it's going to have installed more than a pod. Of course, there's going to be a deployment or a replica set or a stateful set or daemon set. I don't know yet. Let's find out. We can do a kubectl get all and have a look at what it's put in place. Well, of course, we have our pod. It's also installed two services, one called MySQL and one called MySQL Headless. And finally, we can now see that it's installed a stateful set. I'm assuming you know about stateful sets. If not, then there's a full section on this course all about stateful sets. We happen to use them for Mongo on that part of the course, but the principle is exactly the same here. Just very quickly, in case you've forgotten that part of the course, people get stateful sets really confused. It's really nothing more than a stateful set will give the pods guaranteed name rather than generating a random string of nonsense characters for the pod name, and that makes it easier to do things like replication. Now, we're not using replication for MySQL here, but I guess the thinking is here, if you do replicate, then it's easier to implement that using a stateful set. So it really was as easy as that. We could now go ahead and start using this MySQL pod. Well, we don't need to do that for this demonstration. We've proved the point of actually doing the installation. I just want to point out that for all of these resources that have been created, it's using a prefix of MySQL. That's the label that we gave it. But sometimes it will add extra stuff onto the end, such as the MySQL-headless. If you want information on what that service is actually doing, then check the Artifact Hub page and there will be information about how this chart or package works. This is not a MySQL course. We won't go any further with this example. We're not going to use this MySQL server, but I hope you can see that we've got a good starting point if you did need to deal with MySQL. Now, through this course, we've been using a lot of third-party software packages, such as the Elk stack and the monitoring stack that we used, which used Prometheus and Grafana. We've also used MongoDB, where we were explaining how stateful sets work and how you can have replication in a cluster. Well, I can tell you now that I did not write the YAML for any of those stacks. Of course, I didn't. I was simply getting them from some predefined Helm charts. I did tailor them and customize them for the course, and we're certainly going to be looking at how you can do that. That's just a start with Helm. There's still a lot more to come, but I think it might be worthwhile. We're not going to use this MySQL again, so it would be worth cleaning up the cluster. We can run the command Helm list, and that's going to list all of the charts or packages that we've installed into this cluster, and it's keyed on the name that we gave it, the label that we used. So if at any point I want to remove this installation, I can very simply use the Helm uninstall command. You can probably guess it's just going to be the name, in this case MySQL, and there you go, that's now been uninstalled. If I'm quick enough, I might not be, and I wasn't. I do a kubectl get all, you can now see that all those resources have been cleaned up. So that's the basics, but there is still a lot to talk about. We need to talk in quite a bit more detail about these repositories. What is Bitnami? And should you be using Bitnami? Are there any alternatives? And then we'll talk about how we can customize a predefined Helm chart. We're going to be looking at some of the downsides of Helm, and I hope you're going to be avoiding those downsides. And then when we get to that point, we can do some more serious Helm. And we will be going through the case study where I'm going to show you how to generate the YAML for the monitoring stack that we used earlier in the course. And finally, we're going to look at what probably is the most useful aspect of Helm, and that is how to write a Helm template. So that's all coming up, but we're up and running. I'll see you in the next video.